Your Steve Jones Show podcast is loading now. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Purdy Insurance. Visit Purdy Insurance on Market Street in Sunbury or visit online at purdyinsurance.com. Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now, from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
All right, Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors, Key Routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. There's always a great time to buy a car. But here we are. November is coming up. They have some great deals. November is coming to a close. They have some great deals. Holidays are coming up. How about a big bow in the driveway that has a vehicle from Sunbury Motors underneath it? Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors, Key Routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Today's show brought to you by Purdy Insurance. Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. The Purdy's have served this valley for decades. They check every box. I mean, you want to have an insurance company, whether it's auto, home, life, business, whatever it may be, that happen to be experts in it. They're going to find you the best price. If you have any questions, they're going to do everything they can to make sure the answer that you get is right on the money, right, to put your mind at ease. And if something were to happen and there's a claim, they will jump in as if it happened to them. Now, that's the insurance agent I want. Purdy Insurance. Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. Matt Leon on the Eagles debacle in just a few moments. But first, our play-by-play call of the day.
Ben gets the snap, rolls right, he looks, he runs, he dives,
he's in,
he's got a touchdown. Ben has a touchdown rolling right. What a play call at the goal line.
And that's how the Steelers win yesterday, as they rally from a 16-0 deficit to beat the Jacksonville Jaguars. The Eagles and the Steelers are going in different directions right now. The Steelers, to their credit, now 7-2-1 on the season. You still feel like Kansas City is the best team in the AFC. The Patriots obviously also need to be reckoned with, but the Steelers are right there in the conversation. Conversely, some things have been going pretty well for the Eagles right now, for the Redskins to a point. Now the Redskins have lost Alex Smith for the year. They have signed, by the way, Mark Sanchez. We'll let you absorb that for a second. Okay. Colt McCoy right now would be their quarterback. You're going to get a chorus out there about Colin Kaepernick, which I do understand. I mean, Mark Sanchez does not have what you call a great track record. So you're going to have people saying, why not Colin Kaepernick? And they're justified in asking the question, why not Colin Kaepernick? Why Sanchez and not Kaepernick? You'll get that question. It's a fair question. Then the Cowboys are playing their best football this season. And the Eagles have the Giants coming up, and guess what? The Giants have won back-to-back games, and Saquon's coming off a huge game yesterday for New York. All right. So with that as the backdrop and the setup, let's bring in Matt Leon, KYW in Philadelphia. Matt, welcome back. It is great to have you with us.
Great to be with you.
Well, I don't think the conversation's going to be that great because of what happened yesterday. Number one, I want to ask you about New Orleans. In reality, you know, how good are they, and have they really separated themselves from a lot of people in your minds?
I think right now, as far as I can see, there are three teams that are kind of by themselves. It's the Saints, the Rams, and the Chiefs. You probably would maybe want to – New England might be kind of close to that, but you're going – you know, New England's good this year, but you're going more on what the Patriots have been, and you kind of expect them to be. But the other three have just been really dominant, especially offensively. And the Saints are right there. I think you can do things against their defense under normal circumstances. But right now, their offense is playing at peak efficiency. I don't know what they could do better. I mean, they put 48 on the board yesterday. Their big guns, other than Breeze, weren't even huge. You know, they didn't really funnel the ball to Thomas and Kamara. They let everybody get in on the fun. So they're very, very dangerous right now.
Are you surprised that the Eagles have not been able to just summon up something to change even a fortune for a day or for a game or two? It seems like they haven't summoned up anything.
No, I think that loss to Dallas really sucked a lot of the air out of the balloon because it was at home. And everything pointed to them finding a way to win, and they weren't able to do it. And they really, you know, in the second half got pushed around defensively, and they had a hangover from that into this one. This was disturbing. I can only think of a couple times I've seen Eagles teams look this bad, and never in a situation where you expected more. I remember they got lit up in 2005 at home against Seattle. I think it was 42-0. That was a game Mike McMahon was playing quarterback. You know, it was what it was. They got destroyed in Detroit on Thanksgiving in Chip Kelly's, I think it was Chip Kelly's last year, something like 42-7 or 49-14, and it wasn't that close. This game kind of felt like that, where they were never in it, and you felt like they were going at three-quarter speed the whole time, and the other team their foot on the gas. It's disturbing. I said to somebody in the newsroom today, it's amazing to think it was 10 months ago this team won the Super Bowl.
Right, exactly. I mean, it's Darby's been out, I believe.
But Darby's out. Yeah. McLeod's out. They lost Maddox yesterday. They lost Jones again yesterday. They lost Douglas yesterday. It doesn't sound like any of the injuries suffered yesterday are catastrophic, but they might need a couple of guys to miss a game or two. But, I mean, really, that secondary is Malcolm Jenkins and a bunch of people you haven't heard of. And that's part of the problem. I mean, to be fair.
That was my point. That was my point about Darby being out. That's a huge domino.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. But, you know, the secondary being beat up isn't an excuse for the pass rush to not be able to get home. And it's not an excuse for the running game. You know, first play yesterday. You know, everybody talked all week. All we heard was, got to get off to a fast start, got to get off to a fast start. And what happens? They go three and out on offense. And then the first play from scrimmage defensively, I think it's a 48-yard run by Mark Ingram. So right off the bat, you get punched in the mouth, and they never recover. So injuries are a part of it. There's no denying that, but that only goes so far. I think you've got a lot of guys that need to do a lot of soul searching about how they want to finish this season, because it's just amazing how ugly it's gotten so quickly.
You and I have talked the last couple, 3 years, and usually at some point or another, a couple different times during the conversations, the name Fletcher Cox comes up. We haven't talked about him once this year. When you watch him, what do you think?
I don't think he's high on the list of problems. I don't think he's had the numbers, but I also think that the teams are able to put a lot of resources towards him because nobody else is really stepping up, with the exception of Michael Bennett. Michael Bennett's probably been their most consistent pass rusher this year. But you had Brandon Graham, who was coming off season surgery. Chris Long hasn't been the playmaker he was a season ago. Tim Jernigan's been hurt. Haloti Ngata's on his last legs. So I think teams have been able to divulge more resources towards not letting Cox beat them. He made a lot of plays early in the season. I think he, like everyone else, has been pretty quiet the last couple of weeks. But I think it is more because other guys have been underachieving that it's allowed teams to try to eliminate Cox than it is anything that Fletcher's doing or not doing.
Which then brings me to the offensive side of it. They really have not been able to keep the defense off the field, generate what they need. What are you seeing offensively?
Well, they can't run the ball, but they complement that by not being able to throw it either. So
that's a bad combination, man.
Yeah. The running game struggles, you know, people are getting excited, and I don't mean to, you know, rain on the parade about Josh Adams, and he's shown a burst, and, you know, it's been nice to see, but he's a guy. I think he's an undrafted free agent, and, you know, he's done a nice job, but I don't think he has shown anything that you really go, wow. I think it's probably more an indictment of the rest of the running backs that he has played competently, and that has stood out, if you know what I'm saying.
Yes.
You know, in the passing game, Carson Wentz looked really good his first few games. In the last couple games, he wasn't bad against Dallas, but he made a big mistake early with an interception. He was terrible yesterday. That was the worst I've ever seen Carson Wentz play. By the end of the game, he was just looking like Brett Favre at the end and just throwing the ball up for grabs, you know, just throwing it as far as he could and hoping for the best. So I'm more than willing to give a mulligan. I would also make the argument he should have been out there in the fourth quarter. I don't know what they were trying to prove by playing him in the fourth quarter of that game. You might as well, you know, save the bullets, and you know, because the only thing that would have made yesterday worse was if something catastrophic injury-wise had happened to Wentz in the fourth quarter while he's trying to drive for a garbage touchdown in a 45-7 game. But he was not good yesterday. Three interceptions. Didn't really throw any balls that made you say wow. He didn't get great protection, and like I said, they don't run the ball well. But against that pass defense, you would have thought, and I think Doug Peterson said this today, the day after the game press conference, you know, which number bothered him most, the 48 or the 7? And he said the 7, and I agree. I think the 48 was very foreseeable given their injury situation and how they played defensively. The 7, that's not a great Saints defense. You know, it's a Saints defense that gets to play from ahead and run downhill. But they should have been able to do some things against the Saints, especially in the passing game. And they never threatened. I mean, they got the one touchdown. And other than that, you know, they only got into the red zone once, you know. And that's just not good. Zach Ertz was not a factor the first time. And I don't know how long that I watched the game and couldn't have told you if Ertz was in there or not. Alshon Jeffrey had a couple catches. Nelson Agholor, you know, Ertz seemed involved in the offense compared to Agholor. And you constantly watch the last couple weeks, you kind of watch this and you kind of think to yourself, why exactly do they trade for Golden Tate? Because they don't seem to make him a priority. So there's a lot of issues here. There's a lot of issues they got to deal with.
Now, the Giants are not great, but they've also won back-to-back games. And Barkley, Saquon had a huge game yesterday for the Giants. What are your thoughts on this one?
I mean, at this point, I think it's hard, until proven otherwise, it's going to be hard to pick in for the Eagles. I mean, the Giants had their issues, and once again, this is a game you look at and you think the Eagles should be able to score some points, but you know, until they do it, I'm not ready to say that. And you know, aside from Barkley, the Giants have weapons on offense on the edge, and they're going to be going against a bunch of practice squad cornerbacks probably for the most part. So I can't imagine they don't have some success in the passing game. So I'm not ready to say that the Eagles are going to collapse and not win a game, but until you see things turn around, it is hard to get excited about any matchup at this point.
I have to ask you about Jimmy Butler. He ends up going to the Sixers. In your opinion, is he a missing piece? How does he fit with what the Sixers do?
I think he fits very, very well, and I think you saw that Saturday night in Charlotte. You know, they gave him two chances to win the game. At the end of regulation, he missed a jumper, and then he buried the three to win it as overtime was ending. I think a guy that can create his own shot and defend like he does, when you're putting him with a distributor like Ben Simmons and a guy that takes up as much attention as Embiid, I think it's going to take a while to really get this thing cooking on all cylinders. But I think when they do, I think it's going to be a lot of fun. I think it is a trade that's definitely a win for the Sixers. I think it takes them from a contender to a team that you really, really have to worry about now in the Eastern Conference. They are an elite team, I think, or will be once these guys get a good 300, 400 of playing minutes together. And can really start rolling downhill.
In the off season, you work on your game. Are you surprised Ben Simmons isn't shooting the ball better?
I honestly think he can probably shoot more in the game. I think it's a confidence thing. Like I think he's a better shooter than he is showing. And I think if he were forced to do it more, he'd probably be surprisingly better. I think that's one of the things the acquisition of Butler does. You know, now you can go back to not overly being overly concerned about the Simmons jumper, in my opinion, because you're not trying to, you know, hope against hope that Markelle Fultz can figure it out. You've got a guy that can hit the perimeter shot. You've got the guy that can create his own shot now, and Jimmy Butler kind of takes the pressure off, and Ben can do what Ben does best, which is distribute the basketball and drive and get guys backpedaling.
Matt, to you and yours, happy Thanksgiving. Thanks so much for everything you do for us. It is appreciated more than you know.
No, same to you and everybody with the show, and thanks so much for letting me be a part.
Matt Leon, KYW in Philadelphia. We'll come back with more from Cancun in a moment.
as we continue on News Radio 1070 WKOK, brought to you by Purdy Insurance.
For nearly 100 years, Purdy Insurance has been your locally owned, family-operated source for insurance products. With a staff of over 20 and partnerships with some of the industry's most trusted companies, Purdy has the experience and resources to get the job done. Whether you need personal, home, and auto, or complex business insurance solutions, Purdy will help you navigate through the process. Call today at 570-286-5855, or better yet, stop in their Sunbury office to see what Purdy Insurance can do for you.
Great to have you with us here in Cancun today. 82 degrees with sunny skies here. Obviously, that's not what you have back in the valley. But then again, we're coming back on Thanksgiving, and I've noticed that the temperature is going to be 15 degrees. Actually, it's going to get down to 10, right? 10 at night. We're getting back about 10, 11 at night. So Kathy and I have already made our plans. It's going to be one of those when I get back, logs in the wood stove burning, and we're going to go with the Hallmark movie on Thanksgiving night when I finally get back. That's the plan, Sean.
I'll admit, my wife, she's already been into the Hallmark Christmas movies so far. Well, they started the Friday before Halloween, so.
Yes.
But so I find myself maybe watching a couple of minutes. And she kind of gives me that look. It's like, you know, settle in, watch it with me. And it's like, if I do, then 8 o'clock will turn into 10 o'clock. And
I know. You get a long day.
She's like, you want to watch this. I know you do.
I mean, they asked the suit one time what his favorite holiday movie was. He said Die Hard. Okay, so.
That's a great debate every year.
Die Hard.
And also Love Actually. There's a great movie starring Colin Firth, Hugh Grant, called Love Actually, and it's Christmas yeah. all throughout the movie, but a lot of people think it's not actually a Christmas movie. But
well, if Texas is going to wrap up its bid to get to the Big 12 title game, it's going to have to do it without its biggest supporter. Bevo 15, the famed Texas mascot, will not be on the field for Friday's game against Kansas because the Jayhawks have a rule prohibiting live mascots. So Bevo will miss action for a Thanksgiving week game for just the second time in 73 years, according to the school. Bevo 15 is a three-year-old Longhorn steer. The steer has been part of the Texas football tradition since 1916 and has traditionally been a mainstay of the Thanksgiving week games. Bevo typically resides in the end zones during football games. Texas is 8-3. Kansas is 3-8. They'll play Friday night. A win would put the Longhorns into the Big 12 championship game against either Oklahoma or West Virginia. They play Friday afternoon. Texas has not won a Big 10 title since 2009. I worked one game in Austin. It was 1989. Penn State was playing Texas. Penn State won the game. You see Isaiah Humphreys, his dad, Leonard Humphreys, blocked a punt in that game, returned it for a touchdown, and Penn State won it. And during the pregame show on the network, I made reference to Bevo and said, you know what? And this is when Texas at this time had artificial turf in there. And I said, you know, I really feel sorry for Bevo. And the other guys looked at me and said, why is that? I said, he's standing in the end zone. He has no idea why there are 80,000 people here. I said, and it's artificial turf. He can't even graze. Bevo. Bevo, gone.
I was worried there for a second. I thought it was like a health issue or something, or maybe it was, yeah. Even though Les Miles has not officially taken over the team yet, it's going to be a new rule he was going to put in place.
Oh, my goodness.
No livestock. Well, the other day,
Rutgers, all right, now they want to bring the mascot out. You know, the mascot rides in on a horse. Okay. So they have this video up on the board showing them, you know, going out, picking the horse out of the field and the whole thing, and the knight picks him, and the horse is running around and the whole thing. I looked over at Jack. I said, my goodness. I said, this horse gets better run than American Pharoah. What the heck is going on here?
And get Girardi on the phone. Break down the horse.
Yeah.
How fast can he go?
I said, we are not going to talk about that. Okay. So, Mark Sanchez signed by the Redskins. Now, remember, passing game coordinator Kevin O'Connell was the backup quarterback for parts of the season that Sanchez played, and the Redskins offensive coordinator, Matt Cavanaugh, was the Jets quarterback's coach from 9 to 12. That's why they're going in this direction, I think, with Sanchez. You're going to have a lot of people asking about Colin Kaepernick, but here's the familiarity. Colt McCoy is the starting quarterback. Do I think McCoy is going to be functional for the Redskins? Yes, but they're going to need their defense to really step up and play really well, and they're going to need Adrian Peterson to carry the load with the running game.
SMC is where you want to be for your next new F-150 and everything starting with E. Make 2018 a November to remember with savings up to $13,000 on your next new Ford F-150. Sunbury Motors has F-150s starting at $25,669. All SUVs starting with the letter E will plummet in price for SMC's November to remember. 67 Ford Escapes, 23 EcoSports, 22 Explorers, all at one location. Brand new Ford Escapes starting at an unheard of $17,820. If you haven't looked into the all-new Ford EcoSport, now is the time. 2019 Ford EcoSports start at $19,880. SMC has the SUV that started it all, the Ford Explorer, for under $32,000. Hurry in now to SMC so you can show off your brand new Ford at Thanksgiving dinner or to your buddies at Deer Camp. Sunbury Motors in the North 4th Street Auto Plaza, Sunbury.
Taking your calls at 800-795-9565. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now, from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Sunbury Motors Studio is mobile today in Cancun, Mexico. In fact, we're about an hour south, actually, of the Cancun airport. We're at Hard Rock Riviera Maya is where we are, and that's where the tournament will take place. It'll be an 8:30 start tomorrow night against Wright State, and then either SMU or Bradley on Wednesday here at Hard Rock Riviera Maya. They've taken a ballroom and they've converted it into a basketball court with bleachers on each side of it, maybe a couple in the end zone as well, but that's about it. I was over at practice this morning with them as they get ready for this one against Wright State, which comes in at 3-1. And they beat North Florida by about the same margin that Penn State did when Wright State played them at home in Dayton on Saturday. So that's the story there. And then it's either SMU or Bradley on Wednesday. And Penn State football coming up Saturday when Penn State takes on Maryland at Beaver Stadium. Maryland has, to their credit, through what are extremely tough circumstances. They're 5-6 right now, but the circumstances have been incredible for them. And I think they've handled it as well as they can handle it. Let's see. These are the players that are scheduled to be introduced before the game on Saturday. Running back Mark Allen, tight end Joe Arcangelo, who, by the way, started his career at Bucknell. Torrance Brown, Ryan Buchholz, Jake Cooper, Frank DeLeo, Donnell Dix, Koa Farmer, Sterling Jenkins, Trace McSorley, Amani Oruwariye, Nick Scott, Tyler Shoup, Charlie Schumann, Zach Simpson, Jonathan Thomas, DeAndre Tompkins, Kyle Vasey, Jason Vranick, Christopher Weldy, and Chaz Wright will be the ones introduced before the game. So that's coming up Saturday. More on the game as the week goes, by the way. We've got a lot more to talk about with the game. Because Maryland is a team, I mentioned 5-6. Offensively, they run the ball. Anthony McFarland, the redshirt freshman, has two 200-yard rushing games in back-to-back weeks, including 298 against Ohio State. They only threw the ball 13 times. Tyrone Pigram completed 7 of them on Saturday. But that's what they have to this point. They have two. They want to run the ball. That's going to be their MO. And defensively, their stop rate, while Penn State's is 78% defensively, the stop rate has been in the neighborhood of 64% for Maryland this year. But what they do is they get takeaways. They're a plus-8 giveaway takeaway team this year, and they try to thrive off of takeaways. And Trey Watson, the transfer
linebacker from Illinois, has stepped in and leads this team with 5 interceptions so far this season and also leads them with 110 tackles. So he has been a big plus. So that's just a quick overview of that. We talked about the Eagles in the previous half hour with Matt Leon. In the 3:35 half hour, we talked with Ben Jones, statecollege.com. Neil Coulong will be on the show tomorrow. But I know you wanted to get into Ben Roethlisberger. The Steelers are now 7-2-1 on the season and playing great football right now. Beat Jacksonville, rallying from a 16-0 deficit to beat Jacksonville yesterday, and Ben Roethlisberger scored the game winner. And I know you had a few thoughts on that, Sean.
Well, I know we were kicking this around a while back. We were talking about Hall of Famers, and you and I both agree, yeah, Ben Roethlisberger for sure, a Hall of Famer, but you and I were kind of having different thoughts as to, okay, he's a Hall of Famer, but is he a first ballot Hall of Famer? And when I first brought that up to you, pretty much without any hesitation, you said yes.
Oh, absolutely. Look, he's won 2 Super Bowls. Now, one he game managed. He was just a kid at the time. He game managed that one. But the second one, if he's not on the field, they don't have a shot. This is something that we're... I know that we have, there are a lot of guys out there that will take the spotlight. Obviously, Antonio Brown is a spotlight guy. Le'Veon Bell, you know, not here this year, but he's still a spotlight guy even when he's not there. Right? If they have Antonio Brown and Le'Veon Bell, and they don't have Ben Roethlisberger, they have no shot at all. The Steelers have no shot at getting to the postseason, let alone thinking about a Super Bowl, unless they have Roethlisberger. Now, you could talk about how great Antonio Brown is. You could talk about how great Bell has been for them. I mean, it's going to be no longer. You could talk about all that stuff you want. Without Roethlisberger, okay, they're zero. I mean, as simple as that. I mean, look, when Roethlisberger's been out, they've been able to game manage a few games, but suddenly Bell's, you know, everybody's production goes down, right? And their ability to win a big game without Roethlisberger, no chance. And you know, in this century, which has included guys like Troy Polamalu and other like Bell and Brown and so forth, the single most important draft pick was Ben Roethlisberger. Without question.
And the further you pull away from 2004, that was a great year for quarterbacks.
Yeah, it was a great year for quarterbacks. But without him, and the Steeler franchise is not consistently in the conversation the way they have been. Does it mean he's been perfect? No. Has he done things off the field that are just, you know, sickening and potentially, you know, maddening and potentially sickening? Yeah, he has. But when it comes to what he's done on the field... What he's done on the field, getting him to AFC championship games, getting them into, you know, I mean, they have Polamalu. Polamalu's, you know, he's one of the top 5 players in the league. No, Roethlisberger, it doesn't matter if he is. It doesn't matter if Polamalu is one of the top 5 players in the league in the late 2000s. Okay? It doesn't matter. Without Roethlisberger, they're not going to win those games.
Just for some reason, when I thought it was time for him to get into the Hall of Fame, I just figured there'd probably be a backlog and he wouldn't be able to make it in. But after that great comeback yesterday, the first thing I thought of was the Super Bowl. The Super Bowl down in Florida when he you know, marched them down the field to get that amazing come-from-behind win over Arizona. And that was the difference on the field yesterday. I mean, look at Jacksonville. They won the turnover battle 3-0. And as we mentioned, up 16-0 with 17 minutes to go. And this was the first time the Steelers came back from that many points in 21 years. Jacksonville ran the ball 43 times. They had time of possession close to 38 minutes.
They were trying to shorten the game.
Yeah. But you can figure out, you know, what the problem is with Jacksonville. You got one guy who's a quarterback going into the Hall of Fame and the other one isn't.
That's exactly right. See, this is where Jacksonville has trouble. Jacksonville has trouble in this area. Timing means everything. So they felt that they drafted their future quarterback. It was Bortles, 3rd overall, right? And so he's been going along, and people are saying, well, you know, it's really not working out. They probably need to replace him. Except what did he do last year? Suddenly last year, He played, especially down the stretch, he played really well. Okay. And then that brings with it the, now what do we do? Are we going to roll the dice here that, you know, he has solved his problems? Because obviously he played, Bortles, to his credit, had a really good postseason last year. Really good. So let's remember that. Now you've gone to the AFC Championship game. He's played pretty well. All right. Now you're saying, well, okay, let's see if he's going to get better. If he keeps getting better, you know, that's pretty good. Well, what happens is, too, A, he didn't get better. Okay? He's probably had a step back this year. I don't think there's any question about that he has. But because he got to the AFC Championship game, they can't do anything about it. Why? Because you're not going to get a high draft pick. All those quarterbacks last year, the only way you could do it would be to trade up. And, of course, after watching him play down the stretch, you weren't in the mood to trade up. You thought maybe you'd finally turn the corner. Well, A, he didn't turn the corner. And, B, they drafted so low because they made the AFC Championship game last year. There wasn't going to be the kind of quarterback available that they needed to make a move. Those are the circumstances.
So we got Dick on the line from Milton, just checking. He's curious, the view from your hotel room to the Gulf of Mexico, how beautiful it is. He's just curious.
Dick, it legitimately is gorgeous. As I stand up right here in my room right now, I've got a little patio area out here. I look out, I see three palm trees, and I see waves crashing against the rocks. I mean, that's what I see. I've got a little bit of area between me and the beach. It's really windy here today. That's fine because it's 82 degrees, so it at least makes it a little more palatable. I'll say this. When you're out in the sun, though, it really comes down through you. I mean, it's like, holy mackerel. I mean, now I'm here in the room, obviously, doing the show, so it's no issue. But, you know, you do try to find shade as often as possible. But it's absolutely gorgeous, and I think one of the great sounds in the world is when you can, and I did this morning, one of the great sounds in the world to me is when you can sit there and listen to waves crash or waves roll up on a shore. And it's beautiful here. There's no question about that. But there's also a big part of me that can't wait to get home, too. So,
Dick, you there?
Yep, I'm listening. There I listened to that.
He was Dick was mesmerized.
Yeah,
sure.
It was almost like a painting.
He texted me a picture. It literally looked like a painting. It looked awesome.
Hey, we were over at Rutgers on Saturday, and I wanted to make a comment about sitting there, because I've been going to Penn State football since the 1960s. That's a lot of years, a lot of football games. And I just, maybe it's just me, but, you know, and every time I've ever been at a football game, I always had the feeling when I was watching Penn State on the offense that on the next play, somebody could go the distance, whether it be a running back or a guy was going to throw for it. And for some reason with this football team, and this is no knock on Sanders, I just never get that feeling the next play is going to be a touchdown. Do you understand what I'm telling you? I mean,
yeah.
With Barkley, you just felt that way. With Jurevicius, he was going to catch, somebody was going to make a big play. And I just don't, for some reason, sitting there in Rutgers, I just never had the feeling that this is the next play is going to be a big play.
Well, I'll say this. He has been a very workmanlike running back for them. The fumble aside at the end, because I thought they were handling the end of the game, I thought, pretty well. The way they were closing it out. But, you know, he is a very workmanlike running back. He's a very much point A to point B running back, as opposed to Barkley, where you felt like Barkley could go 92 yards any second. There's no question that I think Miles does have a burst and he can rip off that 48-yard run. But, I mean, I can see why you're saying that.
But over the years, I've always had that feeling that somebody was going to make a big play soon. And for some reason, just sitting there, I'm sitting there. There's something different about this football team, and, you know, on TV it's a little different, but when you're sitting there in the stadium watching it, I just never had a feeling that the next play is going to be a big play and a touchdown. I guess maybe it's just me sitting there watching it. I don't know.
Well, it was one of those games, to be honest with you, where I was sitting there like you, and you just felt like there weren't a lot of big plays available in that game. It just was one of those – just keep going. Even the drive at the end where Miles did fumble, three times Penn State, three times in that drive, Dick, Rutgers called a timeout on third down, and all three times Penn State converted. And I think it was just that kind of workmanlike day that they had, where I know Miles has a burst and can break it, but I was like you. You didn't really feel like there was a breakable moment in that game.
Yeah, and I don't know, maybe they played down to Rutgers' level, because Rutgers really – I mean, they played better than that this year. Rutgers is not overall a very good football team. At least I didn't think they were.
And yet the one – I'd say the best Rutgers performance all season was probably against Northwestern. I mean, Northwestern wins the Big Ten West, and they survived in there. They finally beat Rutgers 18-15 in that game. So I found that to be interesting, and I really filed that in the back of my mind that, you know, they seemed to have the ability. It was also senior day too, so they had some emotion. But there's no question one of the biggest problems Rutgers has they need a quarterback.
Well, on the other side of the thing is, obviously a lot of Rutgers fans don't have a lot of feel like going, because there was as many Penn State fans there as there were Rutgers fans, I'll put it to you that
no.
way.
No question. I made a little quick one-liner on the air about all the 26 jerseys that were in the stands. I said, what a nice tribute to Jonathan Sutherland that people care about him like this.
Yeah. But anyhow, it was different. And the first time I was over there to a football game, so it was okay. We parked out at the rack and rode the shuttles in. It was okay. So first trip to Rutgers. Hopefully we beat Maryland and get a decent bowl game, and that's where it goes from here. We'll see. I know we're
going to we'll wait for the college football playoff rankings to come out tomorrow night. I think Penn State might be 13 in that. You know, we'll see what they want to do with Texas. But if Penn State can get to 12 in this thing, if Penn State can win number one on Saturday, that's the most important thing. If they can get to 12, now you're looking at the possibility of maybe being in the Peach Bowl.
Yeah, the guys. Somebody said maybe going to Orlando. I don't know.
That's certainly a possibility. But if you get to the Peach Bowl, that's a New Year's Six. So that would be a three straight New Year's Six.
Yeah,
and that's why I brought that one up in particular, because to me, you know, obviously you want the highest goal possible, and that would be probably the highest goal possible.
Okay, well, good luck to the Penn State basketball team down there. Obviously, the wrestling team takes care of themselves, so we'll see what the basketball team, and even the Lady Lions won yesterday. So,
yeah, they won in overtime yesterday, so, I mean, that was good for them to get. They beat Princeton. The Lady Lions also signed one of the top 10 classes in the country coming in. So I'm happy for Coqui. She was able to do that.
So what's the basketball schedule? When do you finish and get back to State College?
I've got a game tomorrow night here at 8:30. Then it's either Bradley or SMU on Wednesday night. And then we will eat here Thanksgiving morning and then take the plane back to Pittsburgh, bus back to State College from Pittsburgh, get back between 10 and 11 on Thanksgiving night.
Well, have a nice Thanksgiving.
Dick, I hope you have a great Thanksgiving. And, you know, this is what, 7 years now we've done this show. I just want to thank you for all the times you've called, all the great contributions you've made to the show, how interesting and knowledgeable you are, and I want to let you know how much we appreciate you.
Well, listen, being a Penn State fan, it's not hard to follow Penn State, and you're the voice of Penn State. That's the way it's going, I guess.
Well, thanks. I appreciate that, Dick, very much.
I've been back
thank
a lot of years
so
with Fan Fisher
you,
and Tarman
are,
and all the guys, but
you
do the job.
All right, thanks.
Thanks, Steve. Bye.
Hell yeah, he's been a great contributor to the show. I've enjoyed having him on. Hey, we need to take a break. One final break. Back from Mexico in a moment, and not Mexico, Pennsylvania, on News Radio 1070 WKOK, brought to you by Purdy Insurance. Rams and Chiefs coming up tonight, one of the premier games of the season, and Monday Night Football catches a big break in two regards. Number one, the game will not be in Mexico City because of the stadium and field troubles there. It's going to be in Los Angeles. And let's give the Rams credit, Rams fans a lot of credit. They sold 71,000 tickets since Tuesday, and they donated another 4,000. So they'll be sold out at 75,000 tonight. So there'll be some emotion in the stands, as opposed to what was probably going to be a sterile atmosphere in Mexico City. This should be quite a game tonight.
Tough break, though. You could have took an Uber over to Mexico City to the Estadio Azteca.
Dick Girardi and I talked about it, and we both thought that probably about an hour outside of the resort that our money would be gone and that they would throw us to the side. So, I mean, we just...
Savage.
Yeah, we're going to watch the game on TV regardless, so the game's going to be on TV here tonight. We're looking forward to it. Should be. I mean, I think it should be a heck of a game. You want to watch a game that's going to have some points? That game's going to have some points. Maybe we may resemble a Big 12 game. What strikes me about the Big 12 is this. You watch those games. You watch the defensive players leave the field in a Big 12 game. Did any of them seem mad? Never. They never seem mad. It's like, oh, well, give it a shot. Okay. Right. Man, if I'm playing defense, I'd be just furious. Like, I can't believe we're giving this up. They act defeated all the time, these defenses in the Big 12. This is not good at all. And they accept it. It's okay. The offense will get it back. Whew. It's like if Dick and Milton and I were sitting there watching the game, he's like, this isn't football, Steve. I can hear Dick right now. And he's right.
But you and I got the Rams tonight, and Kevin, a.k.a. the King, has the Chiefs.
Mm.
By the way, you and Kevin so far 4-1 this weekend. I'm 3.
What are you?
I'm 3-2.
Huh.
I stumbled with Michigan State, Nebraska.
Well, yeah, I think I was the only one that picked that.
Actually, you and Kev both picked Nebraska.
Oh, Kev picked Nebraska too. Yeah. Good, hey, good for him. That's great. The Michigan State game with Penn State's the one that galls me. I'll be honest with you. I think Michigan State is good, but that's all they are is good. I just don't think they're a great team. I mean, that bothers me. I think Penn State's better than they are. That's back-to-back years where each time I felt Penn State was, no question in my mind, unquestionably the better team, didn't win the darn thing. Well, so, I mean, so that's of all the ones, like, that just really sticks. You know, I don't know. You know, obviously, I feel Penn State won the Ohio State game, they would have beaten Michigan State too, but that's another topic for another day. Today's show brought to you by Purdy Insurance. Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. Sunbury Motors Studio mobile today at Hard Rock Hotel Riviera Maya, about an hour south of Cancun. In fact, we might be closer to Cozumel, the island across from here, than we are from the city of Cancun itself. But it's great to be with you. It's great we've had the ability to do the show here. Neil Coulon coming up tomorrow. Looking forward to that. Beat writer for the Washington Post coming up on Wednesday. We'll talk to you tomorrow from Mexico here on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
You're listening to News Radio 1070 WKOK Sunbury. You can hear us anywhere in the world with the Sunbury Broadcasting Corporation app.